whilst police across the nation were working on Operation Unite, whose focus was to combat antisocial behaviour and alcohol-related crime. We had an unfortunate situation where another young man from our community was seriously assaulted. What we know so far is that Michael McEwen, who is from Bondi and has been living here for a number of months, was walking with friends to a bus stop on the beach side of Campbell Parade near the intersection of Roscoe Street. He had fallen behind his friends as they made their way to the bus stop for the purpose of catching a bus into town to have a good time. We have information that at some stage, whilst approaching the bus stop, Michael was confronted by a number of males. We have information that an altercation occurred at that time. And we have witnesses who say that he was attacked by punches that led to him falling to the ground and then a kick to his body. He now remains in a critical but stable condition at St Vincent's Hospital. And we are here to highlight what happened at Bondi, and we are here to appeal to the public for information. You may have heard something, you may have witnessed the incident. We want you to know that you can call police with information. We will take all information from the community. You can remain anonymous if you wish to. And the Crime Stoppers number for that anonymity is 1-800-333-000. The detectives have worked tirelessly with our uniformed police, and we have obtained footage from every store, every shop, every pub. And we're doing the hard yards. We're going through the footage. We're trying to identify Michael. We're trying to identify people he may have interacted with throughout the night. And we are then following all leads in terms of any descriptors that we obtain. There isn't CCTV that shows the incident directly, but we do have some footage that shows Michael proceeding to the bus stop just before he was attacked. From reports from witnesses, there were 2 to 3 male attackers. There was an immediate response from a number of people. A bus driver driving past stopped her bus and rendered assistance immediately. Of course, Michael's friends who were at the bus stop rendered assistance immediately. And because we had saturated the area in terms of Operation Unite, we had police directly across the road from Michael engaging another member of the public for unruly behaviour, who were able to run across the road and render assistance. And in terms of Michael's serious head injury, every moment counts. And if it weren't for the immediate response to Michael's situation and the immediate call to 000 with paramedics attending, Michael's condition could have been a lot worse than what it is today. I think what's important here, and the message continues to go out, it can be one punch. It can be one push with the back of someone's skull hitting the pavement that can result in death. And people need to understand the repercussions of an assault of that nature. What's concerning is that it appears that Michael was outnumbered as well. What I'll do here is I'll refer now to Michael's father, Mr. Robert McEwen.
The first 48 hours were the critical period. He had another operation. The initial surgery took 3 to 4 hours. The pressure in his brain continued to increase over the next 24 hours, so they needed to do more surgery. They didn't know if he would survive. Nobody would tell us, give us any prognosis. From Sunday morning, he became more stable and the pressure didn't grow, and he's remained that way. He's on a number of sedatives that keep him in a very deep coma. They've reduced one of those, and they'll start to reduce the others now, as long as the swelling in his, or the pressure in the brain doesn't build up. If that's the case, they can reduce the sedatives and start to bring him out of the coma, and that may take several days. if the pressure builds up, they've got to maintain the coma.
Is he going to be all right?
For the first time on Monday night, the specialist in ICU told us that she was confident he would survive. Until that, they wouldn't tell us that whether he would survive or not. So yes, we believe that he will survive. We don't know how much damage will be done. The rehab, that's at the moment we're just looking at him surviving and coming out of the coma. It's been a complete roller coaster. The first 48 hours we were incredibly emotional. It's a funny thing because even though he's been hurt so badly, you grab onto any hope you can. And so on Monday night, we were quite elated that we knew he was going to survive. So that's part of the roller coaster, is that you go through these moments of absolute grief and then moments of elation. And he's my eldest boy. He's one of four siblings. He's an intelligent, good-looking, popular, friendly, very friendly sort of a guy. He was challenging. He didn't accept things at face value. He was a kid who'd always challenge you. He would push back on the boundaries. He was like any teenager, like any early 20-year-old. He was still learning the ways of the world and finding his place in the world. He was in a pretty good place. He was on a good path. He had a good job. He had great ambitions. He's quite entrepreneurial. I would have preferred him to get a job as an accountant or something, but he wanted to take on the world and start an IT business or something like that and be very successful. So that's our boy. He's a really...
Do you want to stop for a moment,
Mr. McEwen? Do you want to help Charlie at all? McEwen, there's been a lot of talk about...
I'll just say one of the hardest things is the effect on the siblings. You know, Joey's only 11 and Michael's his big bro, you know, his hero. And Olivia's 13. How do you explain these things to kids? They don't understand. They hang on to any hope they can get. So Joey's hope every day, he says, "You're going to wake up today, Dad." You know, and that keeps him going because he knows he will wake up. Claudia, his sister, who's 19, they're incredibly close. You know, she's like another mother to him. Even though she's younger, she really mothers him and looks after him. And so it's just devastating on the impact of the family. He comes from a big family, a very big family. We're a close family. He's got a lot of aunties, uncles, grandparents, cousins of all ages, from toddlers up to, you know, a lot older than that. There's generations that have been affected by this. The impact is not just on the immediate family, it's on the whole community, and it's completely devastating. I don't understand that. I don't understand how somebody can have so much hate in their soul that they can actually do something to another person where they put their life in danger like that. This wasn't a fair fight. We don't know what happened. As far as I know, it was unprovoked. But to be able to actually do that to another human being, I don't understand that. I can understand that people have disagreements and they might have come to blows, but to be outnumbered, to have the somebody landing the killer punch on you with intent like that, that's something that's beyond what I can comprehend. If Michael hadn't been so young, so fit, so healthy, he could have been the next Thomas Kelly. If the police and the response wasn't so rapid, if another 5 or 10 minutes had been lost, he would have been gone. He was as close to death as you can possibly be and still stay alive. So to those people who know anything about this, be brave, be good, come forward to the police. Please.